You love.
all sorts of things that are destructive, a light goes on inside them. And their lives begin to change. And he amazingly gets to invite them to another meeting, but it's not a school meeting. It's always in a church somewhere nearby on a midweek or a Sunday. And a lot of those kids and their parents come to those meetings, and those kids and those parents get saved because they see the change in the lives of those kids. And I just think there comes a point, if you've been doing it long enough, somebody needs to say, this is the call of God on your life, and we want to affirm that. And we want to lay hands on you and commission you to do what you're already doing, so that if anybody asks you, you can say, yeah, I'm an ordained preacher of the gospel. Now, he doesn't want to say that in the school system, but he does want to say that amongst preachers. We still want him to be wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove in the school system, because Lord knows we need to get into our school system however we get in there, even if they don't let us take our Bibles in there. We need a voice. And so tonight, we're going to ordain Mark Merrill. So Mark, if you'll just stand here, and Darlene, if you'll just give him support so he doesn't fall out. There's a power here greater than Hulk Hogan to knock him down. So just, not mine, but just stand next to your husband. And Mark, I'm going to let you hold the mic. I'm going to ask you some questions. I just want you to answer them from your heart with a simple yes or no, or I am. Well, let me ask the Mark, have you prayerfully considered the responsibility of living and preaching the gospel? Have you weighed out the work involved and the sacrifices you may be called upon to make?
Yes, I have.
Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that the Holy Scriptures are the inspired Word of God to make us wise unto salvation through faith in Him?
With all my heart.
Are you motivated not out of a desire for position or earthly gain, but by the love of God and your fellow men and the wish to glorify Him and save them?
Yes.
Will you strive to build up the church, the body of Christ, to prepare God's people for the work of service, to labor in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, and reach the lost wherever you find them?
I will.
Will you endeavor to be a life of love within your family and in the community, and so draw others to Christ through your example as well as by your word?
Yes.
I want you to say this with me. I will. Make it my purpose. To live for Jesus. I ask for the prayers
of
this body of believers
to help me
in this work of my ministry
as
I move forward.
Apostle
Derek, Prophet Bob, would you come? Honey, would you join us? Congregate began the turn of the century. And I've just come to so appreciate the depth and the wisdom of this wise master builder, who has raised up leaders all around the world and has decided to grace us and spend some time with us and hang out. Would you warmly welcome from KC 21 Aldershot in England, Apostle Derek Brown.
Which I've got to be honest with you, I think is very often our default mentality. We really don't live in the freedom of sons. We know theologically, but experientially, what it really means to live in the freedom of being a son, we have this hired mental servant mentality. And of course, the first thing is this, that while he's a long way off, with this idea. I know exactly, he's rehearsed what he's going to say, and he goes, I know what I'm going to say. What I'm going to say is, I'm going to say, Dad, I've sinned against heaven, and I've sinned against you, but I'm going to ask you, would you please, man? Before he could even get any of the words out, the robe's on, the shoes are on, the celebration's taking place, because Father's embraced him, held him to himself, and said, you're my son. You were a son, you are a son, you ever will be a son. It's just that you've come back into Father's house, and now we're going to celebrate, and we're going to have a big, big time, because it's all yours. In fact, if you read the parable, would you rather be a prodigal or an elder brother? He gets twice as much. He gets the elder brother's share because he gets another inheritance even after he's blown the first one. And while they're having this party, as one son has already lived outside Father's house and he's now welcomed into Father's house, there's another mean. I think he's mean. I think he's tight-lipped. And he's in the field working hard. So he's not in Father's house. So this is the story of two sons, both of whom aren't in Father's house. Right? Both of them aren't in Father's house. And this one's in the field working. And while he's working, he hears music and dancing. And he hears this celebration going on. He doesn't go to his father because he has no relationship with his father either. He goes to a servant and he said, what's all this about? And you will be with him forever. Excuse me? That's not what he says. It's not even one inkling of what he said. It's nowhere near what he said, which is why Jesus every time. So if you ever happen to be at your funeral and they start saying, let not your heart be troubled, knock on the box and go, excuse me? I've been living it all the time. I've been living this all the time. It's not now. And what that has done has taken the church on the most enormous detour and robbed us of our inheritance as sons of God. It has robbed us of what we really are. And it's robbed the gospel of its power, which is not to say, well, if you, well, what is going to happen if you go out here tonight and you get run over by a bus or you get hit by a car, you can go to heaven. Big deal. And of course, and then we can amplify that and say, and did you know this, that one day Jesus is going to come back again? I want to tell you, I should prove it in the scriptures, he's already come. Then we make up all these weird doctrines about how he's going to come back again one day. Oh, yeah, well, we won't go there because we get ourselves a long, long period of time. A voice out of heaven and act on what he heard, and he had to step in. I'm now God's son. I'm a son of God. And the first temptation that he experiences is if you are the son of God. But I am a son of God. But here's the thing. Whenever people try to take him back to his old identity, you are the identity, you are the son of Mary and Joseph, he couldn't function. The only place that you can function in this world, in Father's house, in the supernatural world, in the world of provision and in the world where everything belongs to you, is the place where you know, I am God's son. I am not Bishop Sharon, or I'm not Prophet Bob. I'm not whatever. I am a son and daughter of the living God. I am in touch with the Heavenly Father, and I just want to be like my Father. I want people to see the Father in me. In fact, if you go on later in John's Gospel, you'll find Jesus said this, I want the world to know that the Father loves the Son, and the Son loves the Father. Psalm 139, first of all, if I go and make my bed in hell, you're there. If I go to the uttermost parts of the earth, you're there. And in the end, Paul explains it in Acts chapter 17. He says this, in him we live and move and have our being. I mean, this is, Bob prophesied dance, so this is a good dance. In him we live and move and have our being. In him we live and move and have our being. Everywhere we go, where's Father's house? Father's house is right here. Where's Father's house? Father's house is right here. Where's Father's house? Father's house is right here. Father's house isn't church. Father's house isn't Sunday morning. Father's house is everywhere, all the time, anywhere we go. It's the world of spirit. We're disciples of Jesus because you love one another. Oh, dear. We tried most things in church. We haven't tried that one, have we? That's the last thing the church is known for, is loving one another. It's amazing. The key, you know, what is the key to church growth? Loving one another. Oh, we don't want to do that. Well, let's try something else. Let's have seven keys. Let's do this. No, how about trying to love one another? Love one another, and the whole world will know you're disciples of Jesus because you will be filled with this super... Did it ever occur to you? He didn't say, be a good preacher, get some good preachers, get a video stream, get all the gizmo. He just said, love one another. And if you really love one another, the world will know. They'll go, that is incredible. That is fantastic. So I've now gone. Fernando's there. He's now in trouble because he's all on his own. You've got 12 disciples, the ladies are sort of around somewhere as well, and they're all locked up in an upper room, and that's it. But I said I'd go to prepare a place for them. That where I am, there you may be also. And as you know, and then when the day of Pentecost had fully come, and they were all together in one place, in one accord, suddenly there was a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Tongues of fire appeared on each and every one of them. And they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And all of a sudden they knew that Jesus, the risen, ascended, glorified Lord, had got hold of him and was no longer just with him because he'd done all the miracles. He'd healed the sick, raised the dead, cast out demons, and done all of that with just with the Holy Spirit with him. But now something inside of him, because he's now speaking with other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance, he goes, he's in me, he's in me. He's not only prepared a place for me, he's now come and he's taken himself and he's now in me, and he's with, not just with me, but he's in me because I know that his Spirit is flowing out. And I feel the Spirit of Father, just as I knew the Spirit of Father when I saw it in Jesus. Now I feel the Spirit of the Father moving in me. And now I can do greater works than I've ever done before. Even though I've healed the sick, raised the dead, cleansed the lepers, cast out demons, and preached the gospel, now I'm in a different dimension because Jesus and the Father have come to make their home with me and in me. Energy, calls it cosmic Christ, call it whatever, from whom, through whom, to whom are all things. This is the one that we worship, this is the one that we love, this is the one that we are connected to, this is the one who has our needs met, this is the one who has all provision, this is the one who has all the money that we need, this is the one who has all the healing that we need, this is the one who just said, I will meet, what Paul says, apostolic Christianity, my God meets all your needs out of his riches in glory, not mine, yours. He says, out of his riches in glory. We've tapped into a field of Jesus. And we've tapped into this field where everything belongs to us. Life, death, things, present, things to come. They all belong to you because you belong to Christ. And Christ belongs to God. The bishop wanted to call this conference Time to Ascend. And the last words of Jesus in this chapter are these. Rise, let us go from here. And my prayer tonight is simply that. Brothers and sisters, disciples of Jesus, become sons. Rise, let us go from here and act as though and see that everything belongs to you.